What's going on,
buddy? Hey, nice to see you, Rob. Thank you so much for showing up.
Absolutely, man.
I was pretty stoked when I saw this welder come in. I wanted to know more about it.
Okay.
I told Keith, I think the people want to know more about it.
Right on.
And who's better to tell us than the man, the myth, the legend himself, Rob Krause?
I don't know. Setting the bar pretty high.
So, Rob, I do have a quick question for you. What is the difference between a CWI and a welding engineer?
So a welding engineer is someone who went to school, 4-year degree to study the science of welding, how to design weldments, things along those lines, different, you know, metallurgical properties, things like that, where a CWI is a certified welding inspector, which is done through the AWS, the American Welding Society. So that now gives you the credentials to go and inspect welds, qualify procedures, qualify welders, things like that. So you don't have to be one to be the other. Two different avenues you can go in the welding industry, in the welding world. Yep.
Rob is both of these things, which means he really knows his welding.
Honestly, I don't think anyone has ever taught me more about welding or cutting than Rob. He does a ton of trainings over here at Purity. He meets with our customers. He helps us out a ton. So,
all right, we get it. Rob is great. Let's cut out the rest of this mumbo jumbo and start talking about the new Rogue machine.
Back in the day, we used to have what was called a mini arc. So and you'll still run into them. They're still great machines. There's still a lot of them still in service. A lot of people will just, hey, you know, I have an old mini arc. Can I still get one of those? So we revamped that into what we call the Rogue line. So we've got the Rogue. There are two machines that are more what I would call stick machines that I can also TIG with. And then there's this version, which is the ET, which is a TIG machine that I can also stick with. So we revamped those, and then we revamped them again because probably the biggest feature, not to jump ahead too much, but the biggest new feature to the new line is that we started incorporating a pulsed stick mode.
Yep.
So, which is pretty new. But these machines are really designed for, you know, maybe a hobbyist that doesn't have a ton of experience with machines and just wants to grip it and rip it type of guy. Yeah. But they're industrial strength, IP23 cases, so they're designed for the environment. They're designed to be dragged around, they're designed to be outside, they're designed to be used on a daily basis for production work.
Yeah.
But super portable. I mean, it's a 23-pound box that I can get 200 amps out of on 220 power.
Yeah.
You know, these are going to be DC only, which is typically what you're going to find in this size of a machine, you know, and in the price point as well.
Yeah.
You know, adding AC creates more weight, more cost. And a lot of people that we see wanting to get extremely portable are using it for a lot of stainless piping, sanitary type piping. Stick welding out in the field where they don't necessarily want to run off of a generator, or they can't get a generator real close by, but they can maybe get an extension cord. This thing's been tested on 300-foot extension cord. You can stretch it out. You can get out there. It's got power factor correction to make up for any instabilities you might have in that voltage fluctuation. So you got a nice stable arc no matter where you're running it. A lot of the small buzz boxes, as a lot of guys will want to call them, in this size frame, in this class, that are stick machines, most of those aren't set up for TIG at all.
Yeah.
Where our stick version I can TIG with, I just have limited functionality. But I can still run a TIG torch if I have to.
Yeah.
Where this one is designed with all the TIG features. So I've got high freak start if I want it. I can do lift arc if I want it. I can run pulse TIG. I can run pulse stick on this one. So I'm going to have a lot more TIG features with the ET, but obviously I can always stick weld with it as well.
So we have our traditional lift to start that you can do with this, but then they also have the high frequency feature.
Yep.
Can you go into that a little bit?
Yeah, so basically what high freak is gonna do is when you initiate, whether you start button on the torch or if you're running off of a foot pedal, it fires a high frequency signal to jump the air gap between the electrode and your workpiece. That way I don't have to contact the workpiece to strike the arc. We see that pretty much all the time in aluminum, but since this is a DC only machine, where we see people that want that is really good controlled arc starts. But again, back to sanitary piping that you're doing on like food grade stainless, things like that. Usually you can't have any arc strikes. So that way they can get into position.
Okay.
Use your high freak start to jump that air gap, initiate the arc. And then the other side of that, when you're running like a lift arc or a scratch start, when you get to the end and you go to break the arc, a lot of times what will happen is as you pull the torch back, it'll want to stretch the arc. It'll want a long arc. And a lot of guys don't like that because they can't have any pucker at the crater at the end of the weld. So when you have a system that's set up with a high freak start, at the end of that, when you let off the pedal or let thumb control or whatever you're running, it just goes out nice and easy and completely extinguishes without having to yank the torch out or snap or break the arc.
I really put the stick in stick weld.
There you go.
Maybe this can make me a better stick welder. Can you go into some of those features and maybe how they help make stick welding easier?
to your point there, a lot of people joke about why it's called stick welding, because most beginning stick welders, when they're trying to strike the arc, they just stick the electrode to the workpiece. So a hot start will help with that. Okay. It will help give you a hotter start at the beginning to make it easier to arc start, but it's only for the start. It's not going to make it better or stick welder.
Yeah.
So, sorry.
And then the arc force, that has to do with the distance that your electrode is from the work.
Well, it really has more to do with how the arc is focused from a penetration standpoint.
Okay.
So a lot of machines would refer to it as dig. Now the universal term is pretty much arc force. Depending on the type of flux coating that they have, because there's a whole gamut of different fluxes on your stick electrodes. Some will have more penetration characteristics than others just based off of their flux. To maybe if I'm getting too much burn through, or if maybe I'm using an electrode that doesn't seem to be digging enough or giving enough penetration, I can increase my arc force to help compensate for that a little bit, depending on what my workpiece is, depending on what my power is and all that other stuff.
And then the other thing was the pulse feature.
Yes.
Is that pulse feature going to help you weld thinner materials?
Potentially. Yeah. So pretty much anytime you incorporate pulse into any welding process, the goal is to reduce the overall heat input.
Okay.
So you've got a high amperage and a background amperage that you're bouncing back and forth between X amount of times a second, whatever it might be, depending on the process. So if I've got a high current and a low current, then I end up with an average somewhere in the middle. I'm ultimately reducing my overall heat input. But what pulse also allows you to do is for a little more control puddle when you go out of position. Mm-hmm. So now when I start running vertical up or I start running overhead, from what I've seen, I notice more of a difference in out of position than I necessarily do on the lowered heat input on thinner material. With pulse TIG, depending on your settings, you can see the arc pulsing. Mm-hmm. In pulse MIG, you can't really see the pulses, but you can hear them.
Mm-hmm.
In pulse stick, you really don't even hear much of a difference and you don't see it. But in the background, it is giving you a background current to lower that, but at the same time, helping cool that puddle intermittently to give you more control out of position.
I personally see this welder in my barn.
Right.
Where do you see this welder really performing well? What kind of customer base is really going to see a lot of benefit from something
like
this?
Oh my gosh. General contractors, mechanical contractors, where they're doing a lot of field welding. They've always got power available, so they don't need a generator, but they want to run off an extension cord and they're going to drag it. They're going to run 4 or 5 inches of weld here, and then they're going to go 20 feet down here and they're going to run another 4 or 5 inches of weld. And instead of dragging leads all over the place or having to move a generator or something like that, you got a 23-pound box I can take and pick that up anywhere I go. And like I said, with mechanical contractors, they're in buildings, they're up on scaffoldings, sometimes they're hanging from the rafters. Those guys get in some crazy positions. So now you've got a short lead from your power supply, you've got a shoulder strap that comes with it. I mean, you can literally hang this thing over your shoulder and be up on a scaffold doing the welding that you need to do.
And what kind of metal thickness limits are you going to run into with this? Where is this really going to shine as far as...
Yeah, so I'm never a big fan of rating machines based off of material thickness. In the world of stick, it's going to be based off of what size electrode I can run. So the most common diameter electrode is probably, I would say, 1/8 inch.
Mm-hmm.
1/8 inch 6010, you're going to be somewhere 90 to 100 amps. 1/8 inch 7018, you're going to be somewhere around 120 to 130. And those are the two most common electrodes that we run into. That's why I just pinpoint those. So on 220 power, this is a 200 amp machine.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got plenty of power. I've got plenty of duty cycle to run that. If I need to run 532 electrode, if I'm getting into something bigger, then I've got plenty of power there for it as well. The thing with material thickness, a lot of times is if I'm getting into, half inch or thicker material, odds are I'm probably going to start running multiple passes.
Okay.
So it's not really based off of the material thickness as much as the electrode diameter that I can run.
Okay.
And with TIG, a general rule of thumb is 1 amp per thousandth of material thickness. So 200 amps, 200 thou, just shy of 1/4 inch. If you were looking at it from rule of thumb right down to that amperage setup. But most of your mechanical contractors, most of your plumbing guys, heating guys, type of that, they're running gauge material most of the time, especially when they're running the TIG process. But you could easily run, schedule 40 pipe with this because you're going to run multiple passes on that anyway.
So just because this is a portable light unit does not mean that we're looking at a light duty machine. You're
correct.
Still able to do that medium to
absolutely
to heavier stuff.
This is designed for industrial applications.
Awesome.
So this torch does come with the machine. So some people like these handles, some people hate them with a passion. That's fine. I mean, that's just, as a welder, you're going to find what you like. A lot of people like what we call the pencil torches, just a single barrel. you know, this has got the flex neck on it, the one that comes with it, so I can flex that into position if I want. And then it's got, as opposed to having a foot pedal that comes with the package, it comes with a thumb wheel on the torque.
Oh, okay. Oh,
so I can run a foot pedal if I want to.
Yeah.
But a lot of times guys that are getting into some funky positions or having to drag this thing up, you know, 3-4 stories, they don't want to drag around a foot pedal. So now if they can get the arc started with their push button and then control the amperage from the handle, now they're not trying to figure out where they're going to put their foot pedal or putting it under their arm, doing the chicken wing type of thing, something like that. So it's a little more user-friendly from that standpoint. But if you want it for a bench welder, it's pretty easy to just slap a foot pedal on there. And if you wanted a pencil style torch, you can just put a pencil style torch on it. So yeah, it comes with a molded 220 plug on it, but it comes with the 220 to 110 jumper. So, and it's auto voltage sensing. So you don't have to tell the machine that you're on 110 or you're on 220. It's going to recognize whatever your incoming power is. And with that, it's going to limit. So you see, I'm at 140 amps. That's the most I'm going to get out of it if I'm on 110.
Okay.
If I'm on a 220 line, I'm going to get 200 amps out of it. And then over here, I've got my high freak option. So this would be my high freak TIG start. This would be my lift arc start here. This would put me in stick mode. And then over here, I can turn pulse stick, pulse stick on or off. I can change my, from a cellulosic electrode, which would be like your 6010, 6011s. I can turn that on or off. I don't have to put it in cellulosic mode to run 6010 or 6011. A lot of welders that are 6010 welders.
Yeah.
There's a certain arc performance they're looking for.
Yep.
And if it's not in 6010 mode, they're probably not going to like the arc characteristics. If it's your home hobbyist sticking stuff together, they'll probably never notice the difference.
Yeah.
So on-demand fan, that's just one of the, to get a tiny box like this, we have to keep the circuitry cool. So as soon as it starts warming up just a little bit, the fan's going to come on as needed. When I'm in, either TIG mode, so I've got 2T or 4T, which is this trigger lock. So on the torch here, my trigger, I could, in 2T, I would have to hold that on the whole time I'm welding and then let off. If I'm in 4T, I would push to start the arc and then let off, and then I could manipulate the torch, whatever I have to do, adjust it. And then at the end, I would just push the button again to turn it off. So it's a trigger lock mode. Turn pulse on or off. If I am in pulse mode in TIG, I can adjust the frequency of my pulses. This one goes up to 500 hertz. So in stick, you get what you get on frequency. So that's just all happening in the background. But on TIG, I can adjust the frequency as well. So I turn that back off. Now I can't even get to that option anymore. Pretty straightforward. If I hold down, I can get my pre-flow gas. So I've just basically got some other options. Ignition current, slope up, slope down, final current, post gas. So I can go into the background, I can make adjustments. So if I was in trigger lock mode, for example, once I start the arc, I could set a ramp up time. So I could have a beginning current, and then the machine would ramp up to whatever my peak current is. And then when I get to the end and hit my button again, then it would ramp back down whatever I set up in the background. And then if I'm in stick mode, and I hold that guy down, I get into cellulosic mode, my hot start, or my arc force. So that's how I just get into the background features. Background current as a percentage of my max current in pulse mode. And then I'm back to the top of my menu buttons again. That's pretty much it. Like I said, pretty straightforward machine. Like all of our equipment, 3-year warranty. And the best support in the business.
Yeah, no, that's huge. Thanks again for showing up.
No worries, man. Thank you.